Good morning. Welcome to Good News Church. Please stand with us as we enter into worship.
On News Channel 7 at 5, we promised we'd tell you a big surprise the Gospel Transformational Living Center is announcing right now at its banquet. That's where we find News Channel 7's Hannah Borkert. And Hannah, what's the big news?
Jeff and Cassandra, in just a few minutes, organizers of the banquet will announce that they have secured a building for those recovering from addiction. They say 16 people will have a shelter from this home.
We just have a lot of folks in our community that are either coming out of incarceration, homelessness, people that need jobs, people that have addiction.
The goal of Gospel TLC is to keep people safe and sober. Thanks to a new building in Weston, recovering addicts will stay 12 to 18 months with hopes of getting and staying sober.
The building is still very empty, and so there's lots of furniture and different items that we're going to need to move in.
All that space is made up of 10 bedrooms, 5 living rooms, and 4 bathrooms. The 8,000 square feet will be home to 16 residents and 2 live-in staff, and it's completely free.
Unfortunately, because of the drug epidemic that is happening in our community and the country, the overdose deaths are ever increasing. And so we want to be this sober place that's going to keep addicts alive.
Executive Director Yao Yang is passionate about helping others transform their lives because of his personal experiences with poverty.
I actually grew up really, really poor. I was not born here in the United States. I was born in the refugee camps. So when I came to the United States, I just understand poverty. And even living here in Central Wisconsin, we continue to live in poverty.
He says a lot of similar services are short term, and people would have to go as far as Milwaukee to find recovery like this.
After staying here for 12 to 18 months, that these individuals are going to be able to get jobs, they're going to thrive in our community, and be contributing members to our community.
Gospel TLC plans to open the doors in August, but before then they'll have lots of furniture and other basic necessities to add. If you'd like to help them out, you can head to WSAW.com. Reporting live in Wausau, Hannah Borker, News Channel 7.
Add some vibrance to your garden with all
the stuff. Your commercial presented to you by... Well, welcome, everybody. Good morning. I'm Pastor Jay O'Connor, senior pastor here at Good News, and especially if you're a guest today, a warm welcome to you. You know, we just sang Waymaker, and it's about God being a God who makes a way, right? We come to places in life, and we might have a dream, we might have something we feel God is calling us to, we might have the next step that he's given us, but we don't have the finances, we don't have a way. And God is the way maker. And so Pastor Yao Yang was the guy who was on the video who God gave a dream to. And he realized because when he planted his church, a lot of the members of his church are people, he reached out to people that are hurting people in the community. And what he kept seeing was that because of the drug issue, the revolving door on the jails and prisons was a very real problem where people would come out, they didn't have anywhere to stay, and so they'd go back to staying with their old friends, their old buddies, and they get caught back up in the drug culture. And inevitably, they'd end up going back in. And so no one was helping them with their problem, and you know their life wasn't getting on track. And so God gave Pastor Yang a vision to have a place where people could stay up to a year and a half, and where they could have some training in job skills, life skills, and the gospel would be shared with them, and discipleship would be put into practice in their lives. And so, a beautiful vision. But Yao said to us when he came to visit us, or when we heard him on the video, that he thought it was about 2 years out, because he thought he had to raise $2 million and build a building from scratch. But God had a way. And so, the Transformation Living Center is going to be opening up in July. And it's not a 2-year wait because they saw a building and it was for sale, it had been for sale for a while. The owner was not only willing to drop the price a little bit, but the owner donated half of the cost of the building. A family from Minnesota was willing to donate, and I don't know how much that was, but it was a substantial amount. And so God had a way. He had a guy who had a vision and started out with not 2 cents to rub together as far as the money for the vision, but God has provided a way. And whatever your dream is, God might have a way. If he's calling you to do something, if it's his calling, he will make a way. Let's pray. Father, we're grateful that you are the way maker. Whether we are struggling with something or whether we have a vision that you are putting into place, you're a God who is trustworthy. You're a God who has the cattle on a thousand hills. You're a God who is generous and good. And you fulfill the visions that you give us. And so, Lord, help us to be a people who trust you. And as we worship today, Lord, we pray that you would fill us with your Spirit, and that today would not just be something that we're supposed to do. Today would be an encounter with you, where, Lord, you fill us with your love once again, and our hearts overflow back to you, saying, God, truly there is no one like you. You are the living God, the one who is the fountain of life. We come to you to drink today of living water and to worship you. Be glorified, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
So we've been standing up here for a little while, and we hiked Rib Mountain the other day, and I realized how out of shape I was, so my legs were a little sore. But I was starting to think, as the sun is starting to come out and the weather is getting into the 80s, like, isn't that how it's supposed to be as we're waiting for Jesus to come back? It's like we're stuck in this month-long winter. It's dark and cold, but one day we know that the summer's coming. Please stand with us as we continue in worship.
I believe God intended for us to be free. We must realize that no arsenal or no weapon in the arsenals of the world is so formidable as the will and moral courage of free men and women. The price for this freedom at times has been high, but we have never been unwilling to pay that price. Those who say that we're in a time when there are no heroes, they just don't know where to look. The sloping hills of Arlington National Cemetery, with its row upon row of simple white markers bearing crosses or stars of David. Their lives ended in places called Bellow Wood, the Argonne, Omaha Beach, Salerno, and halfway around the world on Guadalcanal, Tarawa, Porkchop Hill, the Chosin Reservoir, and in 100 rice paddies and jungles of a place called Vietnam. They add up to only a tiny fraction of the price that has been paid for our freedom.
So this is Memorial Day weekend when our nation pauses to be thinking of those who have paid the ultimate price for our freedom. And so we do pause to remember those who have been lost as well as those who have lost loved ones. It's also a time, you know, we're just reminded of our losses. And so today we're going to pray about this. Our theme today is we're talking about sacrifice today. Sacrificed, and we remember that lives have been sacrificed in the defense of our freedom. We also remember a Savior who sacrificed himself for us, and remember that we are called to be people of sacrifice. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful that there have been people that have been willing to serve and that have gone out to the various battlefields across the world, sometimes here on our own soil, and they have given their lives in the defense of freedom. And so, Lord, we're grateful for the freedom that we have. We're grateful that you have blessed us with freedom, that we can worship here freely today. And so, Lord, we remember them. We also remember those who have lost people in various conflicts, and how today brings those memories up. And we pray for your comfort and your healing touch upon people's hearts. We pray for our veterans that are still recovering, Lord, whether it be physically or emotionally from the trauma of war. And we pray that we as a nation would do our duty to them and in taking care of them. And so help us to be grateful and to communicate our gratitude to our veterans. We thank you for them. We also pray, Lord, I think of Dick and Nancy and the Peterson family. We pray that you would give them the comfort that comes from the gospel and the strength that comes from your love, and just be with them this weekend. And pray for others who have experienced loss, for Sue and others who have lost a spouse or family member, and they come to mind. We pray for your comforting, healing touch upon each heart. Lord, we thank you that in Christ we have a hope of a glorious reunion, and it's not a vain hope, but it's a very real hope. And that one day in your presence, we will be restored to our believing loved ones, and so we're grateful for that, Lord God. We're grateful that we don't grieve in the same way the world does. And it's all because of you, Jesus, and the gospel. Finally, Lord, I pray for Arlene Bett. I pray that you would continue to give her strength and your healing touch, and be with Joe and Heather and Joe's siblings as they support her at this time. Lord, as we go into your word today, remind us of sacrifice. Remind us of the greatest sacrifice of all time, that you, our maker, were willing to become one of us in order to lay down your life. And you said that greater love has no one than this, that they would lay down their life for their brother and their sister. And that's what you did for us, Jesus. And so we also remember, God, that in many ways you call us to sacrificial love in our marriages, in our parenting, in our relationships in the body of Christ, in our relationships with the community around us. You call us to sacrificial love. And we pray that you'd be growing us in this, Lord, because we know we fall short every day. But thank you that you keep encouraging us and calling us forward. And so help us to grow, and help us to see the opportunities around us where we can lay down self-interest and pick up the interests of those around us. So help us to honor you that in that way. Speak to us now as we go into your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So we're in Philippians 2, verses 1 through 11. If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And so we speak of sacrifice today. I just wanted to point out that what we talked about last week, the centrality of the gospel, is going to be very present. This is a very strong example of what we were talking about. If you remember, we were saying that Christianity is centered on the gospel. The gospel isn't just the beginning point. All of the Christian life is centered on the gospel. It's our motivation. It's where we receive our sense of God's deep love for us, for God so loved us that he gave us Jesus in the gospel. It's where we get the love. God says we love because he first loved us. It's where we get the love that can overflow from our lives to touch other lives. Every aspect of the Christian life is centered on the gospel. And so we see the apostles time and time again as they're motivating and teaching and exhorting. They will call us to a change in lifestyle or behavior, and then they will say, do this like Jesus did it for you. And that's what we see in today's passage, and so we will be looking at that. Before we get into that, though, the first point today is that we are grateful for those who have sacrificed for freedom. Very famous letter from Abraham Lincoln. You're probably familiar with it. It was in Saving Private Ryan back in 1998. The letter to Mrs. Bixby in Boston, Massachusetts. Dear Madam, I have been shown in the files of the War Department a statement of the Adjutant General of Massachusetts that you are the mother of five sons who have died gloriously on the field of battle. I feel how weak and fruitless must be any words of mine which should attempt to beguile you from the grief of loss so overwhelming. But I cannot refrain from tendering to you the consolation that may be found in the thanks of the Republic they died to save. I pray that our Heavenly Father may assuage the anguish of your bereavement and leave you only the cherished memory of the loved and lost and the solemn pride that must be yours to have laid so costly a sacrifice upon the altar of freedom. Yours very sincerely and respectfully, Abraham Lincoln. So that mom said goodbye to five soldiers in one war. But many have experienced that loss, and so we remember that today. Remember that this weekend. We also realize that war is not the only place where sacrifice is called for. Sacrifice is called for in our everyday lives. And the example that we're given in today's scripture is the greatest sacrifice of all time, the greatest self-sacrifice. You know, it should never get old pondering the reality that Jesus, the Word, as the Father spoke things into existence, all things were created through Jesus, the living Word. The power, the glory that he was experiencing in heaven, reigning over his creation. And yet, when the question came up, whom shall we send? Here I am, send me. Kind of what Isaiah is a picture of. And Jesus came knowing that he'd be like us in everything but sin. He would have our weakness. He would have our emotions. He would have our feeling of pain and loss. And he was going to go through one of the most brutal forms of execution the world has ever known. And the thing that's unique about Jesus is he walked through life knowing it. And, you know, crucifixion wasn't unique. Thousands of people in the Middle East were crucified by the Romans. They were all over the hillsides. And what was unique about Jesus is that he didn't find out he was going to be crucified the day before or a few hours before. He walked through life looking at those crosses, remembering Isaiah 53, that he would be pierced through for our transgressions. And yet, in his courage, he kept walking toward Jerusalem. Truly a hero. And so our first point about sacrifice today is that sacrifice always requires a personal cost. In 2 Samuel, David says, you know, he asks someone, can I use your threshing floor as a place to make a sacrifice to God? And the guy says, sure. You can have my threshing floor. Not only that, I'll give you my ox cart, and you can use the wood for the sacrifice, and I'll give you the oxen. You can sacrifice them. It's all yours. David says, far be it from me to make a sacrifice to God that costs me nothing. And so we're not making a sacrifice if it doesn't cost us anything. That's what a sacrifice is. There's a personal cost to sacrifice. Jesus is our example of sacrificial love. An example is a behavior or attitude that we are to follow. And so Paul says in today's passage that our attitude needs to be the same as the attitude of Jesus Christ. And then he goes on to talk about Jesus' willingness to sacrifice himself for us. And he's calling us to be willing to sacrifice ourselves, to be selfless. Jesus was the ultimate expression of selflessness. A great personal cost was part of his mission. You know, he was God reigning over creation. And so it says in verse 6, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. And so Jesus was, you know, there's no hierarchy in the Trinity. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are equal. When Jesus became a human being, he submitted and was under the Father. But as you see the Trinity interacting, they submit mutually to each other. And so what it's saying is he didn't feel like he had to grasp on to that equality with God and his position in heaven. Instead, he was willing to let it go in order to become one of us because he knew it was absolutely necessary for our salvation, for us to be rescued. And so he stepped down out of this glorious position in heaven and came to rescue us. He knew that our redemption required a sinless redeemer, something that no other human being was qualified for. He knew it had to be him. He knew that he would glorify his Father through faithfulness and obedience. He also knew that he would be glorified himself through the cross. But that glory would come at great personal cost. He'd be required to suffer. And so he was not just considering his own interests, he was considering yours and mine. And so he didn't grasp onto his position of comfort and status and glory. Instead, he let go and said, I will go and do what needs to be done in order for my people to be saved. And so Jesus was made in our likeness. He was like us in everything but sin. And so it says, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant. And by making himself nothing, it's not saying that human life has no value. We're made in God's image and we have a great value. It's saying comparatively to being in this glorified position as the maker of heaven and earth in heaven, reigning over his creation, becoming a human being compared to that was like making himself nothing. It says taking on the very nature of a servant. You see, human beings were made, and our purpose was to be servants, servants of God. That was Adam's role. But through the fall and through sin, our nature went from being the servant to being the rebel. And that's what Jesus had to come and sacrifice himself to fix. Our rebellion, our sin. And it says, being made in human likeness and being found in appearance as a man. Don't get that wrong. It doesn't mean that he just appeared to be a man. It means that he looked like us, you know, people that were living with him, around him, his own brothers. His mother had a different story. She had an angelic appearance. But his own brothers, his siblings, they didn't believe him until after he rose from the dead. He looked like anybody else. What do you mean you're the Messiah? What do you mean you're called to do this saving of your people? And so he appeared to be just another man. But then he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. And when it says even death on a cross, It's emphasizing not only the pain of a form of torture that was so harsh that the Roman Empire, they were brutal, but they eventually outlawed crucifixion because of its brutality, but it's also emphasizing the shame, the public shame of dying on a cross. You know, Jesus, when I was a kid, they had a crucifix in the front of the church. Jesus is always pictured with a loincloth on. That's for us. It's not really how it happened. They stripped the person naked. It was supposed to be the ultimate shaming of someone. And it was shaming not just in that you were stripped naked, but for Jesus, the righteous one, the good one, the Jews they were familiar with the Old Testament where it said, cursed is anyone who hangs on a tree. And the word for tree is eights. It was the word for any vertical wooden object. A cross was an eights. And so the people would see Jesus on the cross and say, he can't possibly be a righteous man. He's cursed by God. He's a sinner. Shamed, even though he was the one who deserved all glory. He subjected himself to shame and brutality. And there's a spiritual and emotional part to this where when he was separated from his Father for the first time in all of eternity, and he cried out in anguish, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why have you abandoned me? Where are you? As he embodies our sin and receives our judgment. And so, the ultimate cost was his life, the ultimate sacrifice. Falsely accused, stripped naked, spat upon and scourged by mere men, seen as cursed by God. And in all of this, he was being obedient to his Father's will because it was the only way. You know, before we come to know Jesus, we're often confused. And the point of confusion is, what is the means of salvation? What is the means by which I can be accepted by God? And we usually think, well, it's something about my behavior, my performance, whether or not I'm a moral person, whether or not I follow the Ten Commandments, whether or not I'm religious. And we think we can earn our way to God. Paul at one point writes, if man could be saved by the law, then Christ died needlessly. In other words, if you and I could earn our way to heaven and be good enough to make ourselves acceptable to a perfectly holy God, then why did Jesus have to die? But he did have to die because you and I can't earn our way to heaven. It's not about us being moral and in our own goodness earning our way there. It's about grace. It's about a free gift, a gift that was paid for with the lifeblood of our Maker dying in our place. I've often said this to you, but I'll say it again. The thing I didn't get growing up is when I looked at that crucifix with Jesus hanging on it, I didn't get that from the perspective of a holy and just God. You and I were the ones who deserved to be on that cross. We deserved the judgment. For the wages of sin is death, it says in Romans, right? Jesus took our place, exchanged his life for ours, and made that sacrifice so that we could be free. And that's why it says that he has been exalted to the highest place. And that's why for all of eternity, when we worship him, we will focus on the gospel. You know, if you look at Revelation, what are they focusing on as they worship Jesus? It's not, oh yeah, the gospel's great, we became Christians, then let's worship him for something else. No, it's worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Why is that? Well, the gospel is what Christianity is all about. The fact that we only survive and we only get what we get, you know, the grace and the goodness of God because of the sacrifice of Jesus. It's all about the sacrifice of Jesus. And so over and over again in Scripture, God says, as I've done this for you, do it for each other. As I have loved you, so you are to love one another. As I have forgiven you, so you are to forgive one another. I've extended grace to you. Be gracious with each other, right? And here, we're reminded of that once again. As Christ has sacrificed himself for us, We are called to sacrifice our lives for one another. So in Romans it says, in view of God's mercy, in other words, in view of the gospel, in view of Jesus' sacrifice for you, offer your bodies as living sacrifices back to God. It says that's your holy and pleasing worship of God, a living sacrifice. So he's not saying, you know, you're going to get nailed to a cross for Jesus, although, you know, some of us might lose our lives. We don't know. Our brothers and sisters are losing their lives every day in the Middle East and various countries around the world, giving their life for Jesus. We don't know. That could be our experience as well at some point. But in the meantime, you know, Jesus was a sacrifice who died for us. We're called to be a sacrifice who lives for him, responding to his sacrifice by laying down our lives. And so sacrifice, once again, is something that comes at personal cost. Personal cost. And so Paul says, complete my joy. And in the Greek, it means to fulfill my joy by loving each other. By being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. It's not that we're supposed to be like Christians that are cut out with a cookie cutter and we're all the exact same. But these are elements of unity, that we are to be like-minded and that we have a belief system that's based on what God has revealed to be true, and that we have values based on what God has revealed to be his values, that we are a people who seek to love and to be a reflection of the goodness of our God as he transforms us to be like him. And so like-minded, having the same love, a love that, you know, God says we love because he first loved us. And so God loves us through the gospel. And as we grow in Christ and we sit in his presence and we get filled with his spirit and we get filled with his love, he calls for that love to overflow back to him and back to each other, back to the world around us. That same love, a love that's initiated in the gospel, that flows out of us in response to the love we have received. And the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Unity, the unity of the body of Christ. You know, Paul initiates this section by saying, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, these are things that if you are a Christian, you have experienced these things. You have been comforted by his love. You have been encouraged from being with him in relationship. You have had fellowship with the Spirit, and you do have tenderness and compassion because God's tenderness and compassion initiates that in us. He's basically saying, if you are a Christian, if you've experienced these things to any degree, it's a sign of your faith, of your relationship with God. And then he says, therefore, don't be selfish. It says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. You know, selfish ambition is kind of trying to put our self before anybody else. When I'm doing premarital counseling, I often say to the couple, the number one enemy of your marriage is self. That if you focus on self and what you need and what you, that will destroy your marriage. And that's true of relationships in the body of Christ. It's true of relationships in general. We focus on self. It's a destroyer of relationship. Instead, when we focus on the reality that we're loved by God and that that's where we go to get filled up, then we have something to overflow with, to touch the lives of our spouses and children and people around us. God initiates the love that we have. And so we're all to love God and to love one another as ourselves. It's who we're called to be. We were to represent Christ and his love to our world, to our neighborhood, to our workplace, to our school. And so selfish ambition is self-promotion. A good example of it in Scripture is when the disciples were competing to be Jesus' number one guy, right? You know, they even had their mom at one point, a couple of them said, Jesus, when you get to heaven, have my son sit on your right and your left. It's like, come on, you know. Selfish ambition. We do that, right? We do it sometimes in the church. We do it in our workplace, in our schools, in our relationships in various ways, trying to promote ourselves and put ourselves forward. But Jesus said he didn't come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom. And he says, I don't call you to come to me to be served, but to serve and to give your life like I gave mine. And vain conceit is about pride. It's about being full of yourself. Jesus was humble, even though it's amazing that he was humble. The maker of heaven and earth was humble and lowered himself to be one of us. And so this passage is an example of gospel centrality, because as Paul calls us to selflessness in our relationships, to give up self-interest and to be willing to give our time, our energy, our love, our service, he calls us to give up selfish ambition and vain conceit. And then he says, your attitude should be that like that of Jesus. And he reminds us of the gospel. Jesus, who came to give himself, to lower himself, to humble himself, because he knew it was our only hope. And so how do I stop being about myself and remember the interests of others? I look at Jesus, who humbled himself, and my attitude is to be like him. And so, you know, in our flesh, which is another word for self in the Scripture, we have a hard time laying down our lives, don't we? I know I do. And so how do I go from that point where I'm all caught up in what I need to letting go of that? Like Jesus didn't grasp onto his equality with the Father in heaven, but let it go. How do I let go of me? I have to look at Jesus. That's what it's telling me. If I try and look at myself and say, oh, I'm a good guy, I can do this, ain't going to work. That's not how it's designed to work, right? And if it does work, it'll be temporary. It'll be very short-lived because I'm a fallen guy. But if I look to Jesus and remember, Jesus, you did this for me, I can do this for him or her. It changes. There's a spiritual thing that goes on in our hearts when we look at Jesus and the gospel and remember what he did for us. And it gives us strength, it gives us comfort, it gives us motivation, it gives us what we need. And so when I see Jesus again and what he did for me, I can find the power of God to stop all self-promoting and to stop putting my interests before the interests of my brother or my sister in Christ in that moment. And you know, another moment's going to come up in a little while, and what do? Well, I have to look at Jesus once again. It's not like I look at Jesus once and now I got it and I take that and I take it through life. No, every day I have to see Jesus and the gospel and remember Jesus giving everything for me. And it's not about, God doesn't want us to feel guilty because Jesus died for us. God wants us to feel grateful, and there's a big difference, right? We don't want to be motivated by guilt. That's the law. We want to be motivated by grace and by love and by what Jesus was willing to do for me to set me free. And so, you know, sacrifice often involves giving up time, money, energy, preferences at a personal cost to oneself. Time. You know, you can choose to offer some time to somebody that you normally would spend on yourself. Maybe something you would, time you would normally spend on a hobby. I like to play golf. Some of you like to fish. You know, some of you like to go for a walk with a friend. If something comes up, maybe it's an opportunity to sacrifice, to help someone, to visit someone who is alone, someone who is struggling, to visit the least of these. Money. Giving money to a ministry or a needy individual that you intended to spend on yourself. Energy. Taking a break from the to-do list at home to help someone else who has something to do. Preferences. A small thing. Do an activity that your spouse prefers over the one you prefer. Guys, you can watch a chick flick now and then. Or a large thing. You know, what about the question of, do we move for this employment opportunity? Do we move to be closer to family at this time, this significant time? You got to work that out together, but there are times when, out of love for your spouse, you yield and sacrifice. You know, one of the writers I was looking at related to this said, don't be motivated by doing that sort of thing because you don't want to have conflict. That people that report that they give in because they are conflict avoiding, they're never happier because they do that. But if you are giving in because you're doing it as an intentional act of love, they report that those people are happier every time. Because Jesus himself said, it's more blessed to give than it is to receive. And so we get blessed when we give. God touches our hearts in significant ways. Time, money, energy, preferences, and all of those also have body of Christ applications, right? Places where we can sacrifice our time to serve, to be with a brother or sister in need, ways in which we can give money when money is needed, whether it be to Good News or to another ministry or individual in need, or energy. Energy is an important commodity that we have, and we have limited energy resources, but we can give our energy, and we can give in on our preferences. You know, you always hear the notorious story of the church that got into a big fight over the color of the rug. Kind of ridiculous, right? What are our preferences? There are preferences around, you know, worship style and how you do the service and what our plan is going forward, and there's all sorts of preferences. Would Jesus have fought a war over preferences? And so there are times when we need to let go of our preferences and sacrifice our preferences. Why? Because Jesus humbled himself and gave himself on a cross and suffered shame and judgment. And he's our example. That he loved you that much, he loved me that much, and that with our lives, we are called to say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Help me to give up my life, lay down my life in response to the reality that you laid down your life for me. We're going to do a responsive reading right now. I forgot my copy. As the worship team comes forward, thank you. I'm going to read Psalm 51 together. I'll be reading the first portion, and the portions that say congregation, if you would read those together. Let's stand to do this, please. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Surely you desire truth in the inner parts. You teach me wisdom in the inmost place. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will turn back to you. You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings.
Who wore our sin and shame resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. Soldiers watched in vain, was borrowed for 3 days. His body there would not remain. Our God has robbed the grave. Our God has robbed.
Jesus, thank you for your sacrifice. Ruthlessly, the judgment was pronounced, a shameful death sentence to be carried out at the place of a skull for all to see and mock him. Despite his innocence, clearly proved beyond all doubt, despite his goodness to all, despite his love to everyone, this judgment was upheld. But with joy in his heart, he embraced his death so that the will of him who sent him may be fulfilled. So that all, including his executioners, will be reconciled to the Creator, so that no soul will be lost. This is a sacrifice that is beyond all sacrifice, a sacrifice of life which was exceptional. Lord Jesus, thank you for your sacrifice. I know a lot of us have been through something challenging and hard, and maybe some of us are still going through it, but how sweet is it that we can trust in Jesus and the will of him who sent him?
It's so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him and his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know the saith the Jesus, Jesus, save your friend. And I know that thou art with me, will be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust.
So glad you could worship with us today. And worshiping goes on much beyond today. Notice that we are having Vacation Bible School is coming up on June 6th through the 10th from 9 to 11. And it takes a lot of work to get prepared for it. This Wednesday from 9 to noon, we will be having a work day here. It's a wonderful opportunity to come and help get the materials ready and for you to have an opportunity to meet and visit with people as you're cutting, pasting, and doing all sorts of other things. A training session is for all of those who are going to be working with the children. You must take the training session before you are able to work with them. It's this Thursday, June 2nd, from 6:30 to 7:30 here at the church. The next item is a praise item. We have a stretch the budget. We've had all sorts of little slips of paper that show what you could donate. There have been people that have taken those slips. Others have donated money. Thank you. They've all been taken. Please bring the items back and have them here at church by next Sunday, June 5th. CDs and DVDs are available in the back table, as are all information pertaining to Vacation Bible School. The CDs and DVDs are available for $7 to $10 for those of you who would like to have your children and grandchildren learn the songs so you can sing along and have a delightful time at Bible school. Saturday, June 4th, Hager House is having an open house in Wausau. This is a Christ-centered house for women with single women with children. We'd like to invite you to come and have an opportunity for what they are seeing and doing, and we would love to have you help if you are able, so check the website to sign up. Any questions, contact Mikhail Knight. Please mark your calendars for Friday, July 15th. We will be hosting a concert by Living River at River Park at 6 o'clock. Come at 4 for games and fun, followed by a picnic and hang out together at the concert till 9. Invite your friends, your family, and especially the families of the kids who come to Vacation Bible School. Check your bulletin for other items and use it as a wonderful opportunity to pray for the ministry, the staff, and other aspects involved with our church. Thank you very much. Enjoy your Sunday.
Thank you, Jane. Yeah, I don't know about you, but sometimes the words of old songs can confuse me. So how have I proved Jesus more and more? That's kind of an old usage. I just wanted to say something about that real quick. The way we prove Jesus over and over again is by trusting him in the situations of life. You know, Psalm 84 says, blessed are those whose strength is in you. And it goes on to say, they go from strength to strength till each appears before God in Zion. And so you encounter a situation where you're struggling and you need strength, and you turn your heart to God and you say, God, I need you. And you place your trust in him. And he gives you strength. But, you know, you'll come to another situation and you'll need strength again. And you cry out, God, I need you. And he gives you what you need, and you trust in him, and you go from strength to strength until you appear before God in Zion. And every time you trust him, he proves himself to be faithful. And through trusting him, you prove him or, as the song says. Please stand and receive the blessing of our faithful Savior this morning. Actually, you know, I forgot to do something.
Yeah. Veterans.
So why don't we sit down for just 1 second? And if you're a veteran, if you'd remain standing or stand up again, trying to get your leg exercises in this morning. No, it's thank you. We wanted to just say thank you. You know, this is the day that we remember those who have sacrificed their lives, but we also want to take the opportunity to express our gratitude to those of you who have served, because, you know, when you sign up or they sign you up, you don't know for sure where you're going, and there's always the chance that you will be the one laying down your life. And just the fact that you served and were willing, we're grateful. Thank you so much for your service. Now let's stand together. Now may the one who gave the ultimate sacrifice because he loved you so much, he came to lay down his life that you might be set free, that you might have a new life, that you might have the blessing of eternity with him. May he continue to fill your heart, and may he continue to give you strength. May he continue to be your trust, and may he continue to take you from strength to strength until you appear before him in Zion. Thanks for being with us this week. Go with Jesus. Amen.